Recorded Books presents Fearless by Jack Campbell, narrated by Christian Rummel and Jack Campbell.
This is John G. Hemery, who writes the Lost Fleet series under the pen name Jack Campbell. When I started writing the Lost Fleet books, my first drafts reflected the usual way of describing space battles, with only vague references to speeds and distances. My writing group, which includes engineers, physicists, and just plain demanding readers, wanted to know more. Just how fast are those ships going? What kind of distances are we dealing with? And what about relativistic distortion, which is what happens when an object starts going at an appreciable fraction of the speed of light? After all, if a warship's external view of the universe is distorted, how can it possibly hit a target? As a result, I went back and built in real physics. I needed a faster-than-light method of travel between star systems, but inside star systems, everything works according to the rules. There's no magic instantaneous method of communicating with ships light hours or light minutes distant, and no magic sensors providing real-time images of ships light hours or light minutes from your own ship. Working in those real-time delays caused by a battlefield so huge that light takes hours to cross it forced me to make the battles feel real as well. And building in the effects of relativistic distortion provided another real limitation, by forcing the opposing warships to limit their velocity in order to be able to hit the enemy. Magic can be fun, but actual commanders can't count on it, so forcing a commander to deal with the real world creates situations which feel real. Massive warships operating at extremely high speeds in an unconstrained three-dimensional environment aren't going to move and fight exactly like ships on an ocean, of course. But they're not going to move and fight exactly like aircraft, either. Ships capable of moving at thousands of kilometers per second in any direction aren't going to sail alongside each other exchanging broadsides, but neither are they going to turn on a dime and dogfight like sop with camels tangling with Fokker triplanes. I found that my warships operate a bit like ocean-going ships and a bit like high-speed aircraft, reflecting the fact that they share characteristics of both, but aren't either one of those. Given their operating characteristics and environment, though, I did find one parallel with operations on Earth. A reasonable formation in space would in some ways reflect a bomber box from World War II, a three-dimensional lattice of ships operating within supporting distance of each other. As I mentioned in the introduction to the first book in this series, Dauntless, the title of the books in the series come from the names of the ships in the Alliance fleet. My original plan was to have each title reflect a ship which played a major role in that book. Thus, the first book was named after the fleet flagship Dauntless. The second book was originally to be called Furious because that battlecruiser has a big role in the book. However, my print publisher decided it didn't like Furious for a title, so I had no choice but to change the name of the book. After tossing back and forth various options, we settled on Fearless. This caused a bit of confusion for readers, many of whom wondered why the book had been named Fearless when that warship didn't have an especially big part in the story. But now you know. Now I hope you enjoy The Lost Fleet, Fearless.
Chapter 1. Ships appeared against the black of space, squadrons of destroyers and light cruisers flashing into existence, followed by groups of heavy cruisers, then the divisions of battle cruisers and battleships. Massive platforms for the deadliest weapons mankind had been able to create. In the distance, a bright speck of light marked the star humanity had named Sutra, so far away that the people living on the worlds near that star wouldn't see the light announcing the Alliance fleet's arrival for almost 5 hours yet. The Alliance fleet, which had jumped into normal space here, appeared to be incredibly powerful as its formations fell towards Sutra. It seemed impossible that something so strong could fear anything. But the Alliance fleet was running for its life, and Sutra, deep within the enemy territory of the Syndicate Worlds, was but a necessary stepping stone on the way to ultimate safety.
"We have detections of Syndicate World's light warships at 10 light minutes, bearing 10 degrees down to starboard."
Captain John Blackjack Geary sat in the fleet commander seat on the bridge of the Alliance battlecruiser Dauntless, feeling overtensed muscles slowly relax as it became apparent he'd once more guessed right. Or the Syndicate fleet commanders had guessed wrong, which was just as good. No minefields had awaited the Alliance fleet as it exited from the jump point, and the enemy warships so far spotted posed no real threat to his fleet. No, the major threat to his ships remained inside the fleet itself. Geary kept his eyes on the three-dimensional display projected before him, watching to see if the neat ranks of the Alliance formation would dissolve into chaotic pursuit of the Syndic ships, as discipline gave way to a desire to get in on a kill. "Captain Dijani," he directed the commanding officer of the Dauntless, "please broadcast a demand to those Syndicate warships to surrender immediately."
"Yes, sir."
Tanya Dijani had learned to hide her reactions to Geary's old-fashioned and, to the thinking of modern times, soft-hearted concepts like granting the option of surrender to an enemy force that could easily be destroyed. He had slowly learned why she and the others in the fleet felt that way. The Syndicate worlds had never been known for the humanity of their rulers, or for concepts like individual freedom and justice that the worlds of the Alliance held dear. The unprovoked, surprise attacks by the Syndics, which had started this war, had left a bitter taste that still lingered. And over the century since then, the Syndics had taken the lead in a race to the bottom when it came to win-at-any-price tactics. Geary had been shocked to learn that the Alliance had come to match the Syndics atrocity for atrocity. And even though he now understood how that had happened, he would never tolerate it. He insisted on abiding by the old rules he'd known, rules that tried to control the rage of war so that those fighting it didn't become as bad as their enemies. Geary checked the system display for at least the 10th time since sitting down. He'd already memorized it before then. The jump point his fleet had exited was just under 5 light hours from Sutra. 2 worlds in the system were inhabited, but the nearest of those to the fleet was only 9 light minutes from the star. It wouldn't see the arrival of the Alliance fleet in this system for another 4.5 hours. The other inhabited world was slightly farther away from the fleet, a mere 7.5 light minutes from Sutra. The Alliance fleet wouldn't have to go close to either, as it transited Sutra star system en route to another jump point on the other side from which it could make the leap to another star. Around the depiction of the Alliance fleet on the system display, an expanding bubble marked the area in which something like a real-time picture of events could be evaluated. Right now, the fleet could see what the closest inhabited world had looked like 4.5 light hours ago. That was a comfortable margin, but it also allowed a lot of time for unanticipated events to pop up and surprise you when the light from them finally arrived. The star Sutra itself could have exploded 4 hours ago, and they wouldn't see the light from the event for almost another hour.
"Redshift on the Syndic ships," a watchstander announced, unable to keep disappointment out of his voice.
"They're running," Dijani added unnecessarily.
Geary nodded, then frowned. The massively outnumbered Syndic force they'd encountered at Corvus had nevertheless fought, with only one ship ultimately surrendering, but 3 others annihilated.
"The Syndic commander there cited Syndic fleet regulations as requiring that suicidal action. Why are the Syndics here behaving differently?"
"Why?" he asked out loud. Captain Dijani gave Geary a surprised look.
"They're cowards."
Geary managed not to snap out a forceful reaction. Dijani, like so many of the other sailors and officers in the Alliance, had been fed propaganda about the Syndic enemy for so long that they believed it all, even when it didn't make sense.
"Captain, 3 of the Syndic ships at Corvus fought to the death. Why are these running?"
Dijani frowned in turn.
"Syndics follow orders rigidly," she finally declared.
That was a fair assessment, reflecting everything Geary had once known and what he'd seen now.
"Then they've been ordered to run."
"To report our arrival in the Sutra system," Dijani concluded. "But what's the point of that? If they've got light units posted at the other jump points, and we can see that as of a few hours ago they did, what advantage do they gain by having someone right here? Their report still goes out at light speed, and since they can't get through us to the nearest jump point, they won't be able to jump out quickly."
Geary brooded over the display.
"True enough. So why?"
He took another look at his fleet's formation, still holding together, and breathed a prayer of thanks to the living stars.
"Wait a minute."
Within a solar system, directional references were always made to the world outside a ship, so other ships could understand them. Anything above the plane of the system was up, anything below it down. The direction toward the sun was right or starboard, or even starward, as some urged.
while the direction away from the sun was left, or port. Using that standard convention, the Syndic light warships had been below the position of his fleet, and were now fleeing up and slightly to the left. Why would they run in a way that brought them closer to his fleet? Unless running in that way had another purpose. Geary drew an intercept line from his ships to the Syndics, the curving course tracing through a region the Syndics hadn't gone through.
Get me a real good look at this area. Fast.
Dejani gave Geary a startled glance, but passed the order on. Geary was still waiting for the reply when he saw three destroyers and a heavy cruiser suddenly break formation, leaping forward under full acceleration to intercept the fleeing Syndics.
No, you fools.
Without waiting another moment, Geary keyed the fleet command circuit.
All units, alter course up 30 degrees. I say again, up 30 degrees, immediate execute. There are mines along our projected track.
He took a moment to identify the units that had broken formation.
Analyse, Basilard, Mace, Cuirass, break up from your formation course immediately. Up 30 degrees. You are entering a minefield.
Then all Geary could do was stare at the display. The Alliance fleet was spread across light minutes of distance. The farthest ships wouldn't receive his order for another 2 minutes. The ones in greatest danger, those three destroyers and the cruiser Cuirass, wouldn't hear it for at least a minute. At full acceleration, they'd cover a lot of ground in that minute. A watchstander on the bridge of Dauntless was making her report in a loud voice.
Anomalies detected along the track indicated. Assess better than 80% probability of stealth mines in the area. Recommend avoidance course now.
Dejani held up a hand to acknowledge the report, then gazed at Geary, her eyes filled with admiration. Geary realized that the eyes of the other officers and sailors on the bridge reflected the same amazement, as well as the hero worship he really hated seeing, even after months of it.
How did you know, Captain Geary?
Dejani asked.
It was just too obvious, he explained, shifting uncomfortably in his seat under the regard of the other officers on the bridge. The warships positioned far enough from the jump point to avoid incoming enemies, but close enough to warn off friendly shipping. Then that course they took, which seemed aimed at taking us through a certain area when we pursued.
He left off something they both knew, that if this fleet had been the same one he'd brought into Corvus, most of his ships would be rushing headlong into that minefield right now, instead of only four lighter units. The widespread formation of the Alliance fleet began bending in the middle as the nearest ships reacted to the order. Then, as the order reached farther ships, they responded too. The overall image almost resembled a manta ray, Geary realized, flexing up in the middle with the wings still drooping lower. He waited, seeing the three destroyers and the cruiser maintaining their courses, as if the pursuit was all that mattered. Geary checked the time. 5 minutes had passed. Give it 1 minute for the order to arrive at the speed of light, then another minute for him to finally see whatever course change the ship started. That left 3 minutes, which was way too slow a response in an emergency.
Analyse, Basilard, Mace, Cuirass. Alter course upward immediately, maximum turn. We've detected a minefield across your tracks. Acknowledge order and start turn immediately.
Another minute. How far away are they from those anomalies? Geary asked, trying to keep his voice level.
On current track?
Dejani tapped her own controls rapidly, running the calculation.
They'll be in among them in 30 seconds.
Dejani's voice was calm, disciplined. She had seen a lot of Alliance ships die, a lot of Alliance sailors die, in her fairly short career. Geary had only gradually learned that, and realized that now Dejani was drawing on her experience to numb herself to what seemed inevitable. 30 seconds. Too late to even try broadcasting another order. Geary knew some of the commanding officers in his fleet weren't really qualified for command, knew that many others still clung to the idea of all-out glorious charges into the enemy without hesitation or thinking. It would be a long time before he could, hopefully, teach those warriors the value of fighting wisely as well as bravely. But even knowing that, Geary wondered what insanity had led those four captains to ignore his orders and his warning about the minefield. Their minds must be fixed on their chosen targets,
oblivious to anything else as they tried to close to engagement range. Maybe the ships would survive in the minefield long enough for another warning to work. Trying to keep his voice from betraying desperation, Geary called them again. Analace, Basilard, Mace, Cuirass, this is the fleet commander. You are entering a confirmed minefield. Alter course immediately. Maximum turn. They were entering the minefield now, he knew. The light from the four ships was half a minute old, so the ships that he could see, proud and intact, were already in the minefield. Might already have hit mines. All he could do was stare at the display, waiting for the inevitable. Knowing there was nothing that could save the crews of those ships now but an actual miracle. He prayed silently, wishing for that miracle. It didn't happen. Exactly 1 minute, 7 seconds after Desjani's warning, Geary saw his display reporting multiple explosions as the three destroyers leading the charge ran into the dense minefield. The small, relatively frail destroyers simply disintegrated under the hammer blows of the mines, shattering into fragments of men, women, and ships that the smart fuses of unexploded mines simply ignored. A few seconds after that, Geary saw the cuirass finally trying to turn. It was far too late, though, as momentum carried the cruiser into the mines. One punched a crater amidships, then a second blew away a good part of the stern. Then the optical sensors on the Dauntless momentarily lost sight of the cruiser as the debris field from it and the destroyers blocked the view of the destruction. Geary licked lips suddenly gone dry, thinking of the sailors who just died to no purpose. He blocked out emotion, concentrating on the mechanics of his next task as he studied the display.
Second Destroyer Squadron, you are to make a cautious approach to the vicinity of the minefield in search of survivors. Do not enter the minefield without approval from me.
Odds were there wasn't a single survivor. The four ships had been destroyed so quickly it seemed unlikely anyone could have reached a survival pod. But it was necessary to ensure no one was left behind to the tender mercies of the Syndic labor camps. A slow minute passed.
Second Destroyer Squadron, aye, proceeding to search for survivors.
The voice of the squadron commander was subdued. Geary took another look at his formation, all on the new course, rising above the plane of the Sutra system, coursing above the minefield area now prominently labeled with danger signs on the display.
All units alter course 20 degrees down at time 15.
Everyone was looking at him, perhaps expecting some speech about the heroism of the crews of the four ships. Geary stood up, his mouth a thin line, shook his head, and walked off the bridge, not trusting his voice. The dead shouldn't be spoken ill of. He didn't want to publicly lash the commanders of those ships as vainglorious fools who'd murdered their crews, even though that was exactly what had happened. Victoria Rione, co-president of the Callus Republic and a member of the Alliance Senate, was waiting for him at the entry to his stateroom. Geary nodded to her with one quick jerk of his head, then entered without inviting her inside. She came anyway, standing silently while he glowered at the starscape that decorated one bulkhead. She didn't have any command authority in the fleet, but as a senator, she was a senior enough representative of the Alliance government that Geary certainly couldn't just throw her out. Besides, the ships of both the Callus Republic and the Rift Federation, which made up part of his fleet, would listen to orders given by Rione if she decided to buck Geary. He had to be diplomatic with this civilian politician, even when all he wanted to do was yell at someone. Finally, he just glared at her. "What do you want, Madam Co-President?"
"To hear you relieve the anger that is devouring you at the moment," she replied calmly.
He slumped for a moment, then slammed his fist into the starscape, making it shimmer briefly before returning to normal.
"Why? Why would anyone be so stupid?"
"I saw this fleet at Corvus, Captain Geary. The Syndic tactic would have worked perfectly there. Before, the training you insisted upon taught the fleet better discipline."
"Is that supposed to make me feel better?" he asked bitterly.
"It should."
Geary rubbed his face with one hand.
"Yeah," he agreed wearily. "It should. But even one ship. And we just lost four.
Rione gave him a penetrating look. At least they presented an object lesson on the value of following orders. He stared back at her, wondering if she was serious.
That's a little too cold-blooded for me, Madam Co-President.
She shrugged. You have to be realistic, Captain Geary. Unfortunately, there are some people who refuse to learn until they see errors literally blow up in their faces. Her voice fell and her eyes closed. This happened just now.
So she was affected by the losses.
Geary felt a surge of relief. As the only civilian in the fleet, the only person not under his command, Rione was the only person he felt able to confide in. He was beginning to discover he also liked her. An unfamiliar feeling for him, after the isolation of being in a time a century removed from his own. After the isolation of finding himself among people whose culture had changed in many ways, large and small, from the one Geary had known. Rione looked up again.
Why, Captain Geary? I don't pretend to be an expert on the military, but those four ship commanders had seen that your way of doing things worked. The way the fleet used to fight back in your time. They'd seen a large Syndic force destroyed to the last ship. How could they possibly believe that charging headlong at the enemy was wise?
Geary shook his head, not looking at her.
Because, to the great misfortune of humanity, military history is very often the story of commanders repeating the same unsuccessful way of fighting again and again, while their own forces are destroyed in droves. I don't pretend to know why that is, but it's a sad truth. Commanders who don't learn from immediate or long-term experience, who keep hurling their forces forward, as if causing the same useless deaths time and again will eventually change the outcome.
Surely not all commanders could be like that.
No, of course not. Though it seems they tend to collect in the highest ranks, where they can do the most damage.
Geary finally looked over at Rione.
Many of these ship commanders are good, brave sailors. But they've spent their entire careers being told how to fight one way. It'll take a while to overcome all of that hidebound experience and convince them that change is not a bad thing. Change doesn't come easily to the military, even when that change is a return to the professional tactics of the past. It's still change from the way things are.
Rione sighed and shook her head.
I've seen the many ancient traditions that the military holds dear, and sometimes wonder if it thereby attracts too many of those who value lack of change over accomplishment.
Geary shrugged. Maybe. But those traditions can be a tremendous source of strength. You told me some time back that this fleet was brittle, prone to break under pressure. If I can successfully reforge it stronger, it'll be in no small part because of the traditions that I can draw on.
She accepted his statement without any sign of whether or not she believed it.
I do have some information that may help to partially explain the actions of those four ships. Since we left jump space and the communications net became active, some of my sources have reported that rumors have been spread through ships. Rumors that you, having lost your fighting spirit, would rather allow Syndic warships to escape to fight another day than risk engaging them.
Geary found himself laughing in disbelief. How could anyone believe that after Caliban? We tore that Syndic flotilla apart. Not a one got away.
People will believe what they wish to believe, Rione observed.
You mean like believing Blackjack Geary is a mythical hero? He asked sourly. Half the time they want to worship me, the warrior from the past who's going to save this fleet and the Alliance by winning a war a century old. And the other half of the time they spread rumors that I'm incompetent or afraid.
Geary finally sat down, gesturing Rione to a seat opposite him.
So what are your spies and my fleet telling you, Madam Co-President?
Spies? She repeated in a surprised tone as she sat down. That's such a negative term.
It's only negative if the spies are working for your enemy.
Geary rested his chin on one fist, regarding her.
Are you my enemy?
You know I distrust you, Rione replied. At first it was because I feared the hero worship that could make you as big a threat to the Alliance and this fleet as the Syndics. Now it's because of that, and because you've proven yourself a very capable man. That combination is very dangerous.
But as long as what I'm doing is in the best interests of the Alliance, we're on the same side?
Geary inquired, letting some sarcasm show.
I'm worried about what that mine ambush says about our enemy, Madam Co-President.
She frowned at him. What does it tell you about our enemy that you did not already know?
It says the Syndics are thinking. It says they're being smart, like when they tricked this fleet into taking their hypernet to the Syndic home system so it could run into a war-ending ambush.
Which would have succeeded if not for the unlooked-for presence of the century-old hero of the Alliance, Captain Blackjack Geary, Rione stated half-mockingly. Found on the edge of final death in a lost survival pod, like an ancient king miraculously returned to life to save his people in their hour of greatest need.
He grimaced back at her. To you, that's funny, because you don't have to live with people believing you're that person.
I've told you that you are that person. And no, I don't find it funny at all.
Geary wished he understood her better. Since being rescued, he'd been in the military environment of the fleet and had been badly surprised by some of the cultural changes wrought by a century of bitter war. But his only direct contact with civilian culture in the Alliance was Victoria Rione, and she kept much hidden. He couldn't tell how much had changed back home, and in what ways, and he really wanted to know. But Rione isn't likely to help me better understand Alliance civilian culture if she thinks I could use that knowledge to make myself more of a threat to the Alliance government. Maybe someday she'll trust me enough to unwind about such things.
Geary sat forward, working the controls on the table between them that still seemed a bit unfamiliar, even after months in this stateroom. An image of Sutra sprang up, next to a larger display of the stars near Sutra.
We're going to go through the rest of this system very carefully. I assume the Syndics laid similar minefields near the other jump points, but we can spot them and avoid them now that we know to look.
Rione pointed to symbols on the display. 2 Syndic military bases? Are either a threat?
They don't look like it from what we can see. Obsolete to all appearances. What we'd expect in a system not on the Syndic hypernet.
He let his gaze rest on the depictions of the Syndic bases, thinking about the hypernet that had changed things so much since what he thought of as his time. Much faster than the system jump faster than light method, and with unlimited range between the gates of the hypernet, it had revolutionized interstellar travel and left countless star systems to wither like broken twigs when they weren't judged special enough to justify the expense of a gate. Geary punched the update key, and the latest information on Sutra system was presented. The only change was in the positions of the light Syndic warships, which had lured his 4 ships into the minefield. Those Syndics were still running, heading away from Geary's forces at velocities edging toward 0.2 light speed. They'd been accelerating so fast that their inertial compensators must be badly stressed and their crews pinned to their seats by leak through. Chasing them would be futile, since they could simply keep heading away while the Alliance fleet sooner or later had to proceed to one of the jump points out of Sutra. But Geary still felt a tide of anger sweep over him at the sight of the Syndic ships, knowing vengeance was out of the question in this case. But the Syndic ambush bothered him for reasons beyond that. Rione didn't seem to understand the implications. The survival of the Alliance fleet depended upon Geary making the right decisions and the Syndic command making the wrong decisions. If the Syndics had lost their overconfidence and begun carefully planning, then even Geary's best moves might fail to keep the Alliance fleet at least one step ahead of Syndic forces strong enough to deal the Alliance forces a death blow. Though even the little blows could add up. Out of the hundreds of ships in the Alliance fleet, the 4 lost here weren't critical. But the fleet could be nibbled to death over time by taking such losses at star after star, and there were a lot of stars between the fleet and home. He glanced at the display, wishing Sutra were a lot closer to Alliance space. Wishing Sutra had somehow miraculously gained an unguarded hypernet gate. Hell, as long as he was at it, why not wish he'd died on his ship a century ago, so he wouldn't be in command of this fleet now, with so many lives and ships depending upon him? Snap out of it, Geary.
You had every right to be depressed when they thawed you out, but you're past that now.
The communicator chimed for his attention.
Captain Geary, we've spotted something important.
Captain Dejani's voice held some emotion he couldn't quite identify.
Important?
If it was a threat, surely she'd have just said that.
On the fifth world of the system, it looks like a labor camp.
Geary gave Rione a glance to see how she was taking the news, but Rione didn't seem to find it remarkable either. The Syndicate Worlds had a lot of labor camps, because the Syndicate Worlds devoted a lot of effort to dealing with real or imagined internal enemies.
Is there something special about it?
This time he could clearly identify the strain in Dejani's voice.
We're picking up communications from the camp that indicate it holds Alliance prisoners of war.
Geary stared at the depiction of the fifth world in the Sutra system. 9 light minutes from its star, still a bit over 4 light hours from the Alliance fleet. He hadn't expected to be going near the inhabited worlds of this system, hadn't anticipated any delays. It looked like his plans would have to change.
I hate these meetings, Geary thought for perhaps the 100th time, which was impressive, given that he'd only had to attend about 5 of the things so far. Inside the briefing room, the conference table was actually only a few meters long. But thanks to the communications net connecting the ships of the fleet and the latest virtual presence technology, the table now seemed to run off into the distance, seat after seat occupied by commanders of his ships. The most senior officers were apparently seated the closest to Geary, but all he had to do was look at any officer, no matter how far down the table, and they'd loom close, identification information helpfully appearing right next to them. Granted, the conferences had an odd rhythm to them. The fleet had been drawn into a much tighter formation for the conference, but because of light speed limitations on the communications, the farther off ships were still 20 or even 30 light seconds off. Those were the smallest ships with the most junior commanders, of course, the ones who were expected to watch, learn, and keep their mouths shut. So the delayed action nature of their interactions had little impact. But even for closer ships, there could be several seconds delay between question and answer, so the participants had learned to speak, pause, allowing time for interjections and commands to arrive. Captain Numos, commanding officer of the Orion, was staring down his nose at Geary, doubtless still seething over his own poor performance at Caliban, which of course Numos blamed on Geary rather than himself. Near Numos sat Captain Fariza of the Majestic, her expression as acidic as usual. Geary wondered why Fariza didn't somehow dissolve the table surface just by glaring at it. In welcome counterpoint to those two, Captain Duelos of the Courageous lounged in his chair, apparently relaxed but with alert eyes, and Captain Tulov of the Leviathan sat stolidly, his dismissive gaze fixed on Numos and Fariza. Further down the table, fiery Commander Cressida of the Furious grinned openly at the prospect of more action, while not far from her appeared to sit Colonel Caraballi, the senior surviving Marine in the fleet and another capable and dependable officer. Actually sitting next to Geary was Captain Dejani, the only other person physically present in the crowded room. Co-President Rione had begged off attending, but Geary knew the officers of the ships from the Rift Federation and the Callous Republic would provide Rione with a full report of everything that happened. He suspected she'd avoided being here in person in order to see what he'd say in her absence. Geary nodded brusquely to the assembled officers.
First of all, let us pay respect to the crews of the destroyers Analace, Basilard, and Mace, and of the cruiser Cuirass, who were in the arms of their ancestors, having died in the line of duty in defense of their homes and families.
He felt a bit of a hypocrite to not add in a denunciation of the behaviors that had led those ships to their deaths, but that still seemed out of place.
Are we sure that there were no survivors?
Someone asked. Geary gestured to the commander of the second destroyer squadron, who cleared his throat and looked unhappy as he answered.
We conducted a thorough search. The only survival pods located were all badly damaged and inactive.
Numos spoke, his voice harsh.
We should have pursued those Syndic hunter-killer ships and made them pay for destroying those ships and killing their crews.
How would you have caught them? Duelos asked in a drawl that clearly conveyed contempt.
A full-scale pursuit at maximum acceleration, of course.
The youngest officer in the fleet knows the laws of physics wouldn't allow us to catch those ships, without chasing them halfway to the next star and burning up nearly all of our fuel in the process.
Captain Fariza intervened, her voice sour. An officer in the Alliance fleet shouldn't give up before starting. Attempt the impossible and you will achieve it.
The way the quote was delivered sounded depressingly familiar.
Geary glanced at Captain Dejani, who nodded at him, unable to suppress a proud look.
Another quote from Blackjack Geary, doubtless taken completely out of context, if he'd ever actually said it at all, and used to justify things that the real Blackjack never would have supported, and certainly didn't support now.
"I'll have to look up just when I said that and what I meant," he replied, keeping his voice even.
"But I agree completely with Captain Duelos. Pursuit would have been futile.
I have to place responsibility for this entire fleet above my desire for revenge, and I'd expect any other officer to do the same."
"This fleet has grown used to expecting the fleet flagship to lead the way into battle,"
Fariza stated, as if that somehow proved an argument.
Geary bit back a vicious comment.
"Just because the fleet's grown used to expecting stupidity doesn't mean I have to be stupid."
But Dejani answered for him, her pride clearly affronted by an implied insult to her ship, as well as to Geary. "Dauntless was in the center of the formation at Caliban, right where the Syndics aimed their attack,"
Dejani noted in a formally stiff voice.
"Yes," Geary agreed.
"Though to be honest, because of the way I'd set up the battle with my fleet's firepower concentrated on the aim point of the Syndic attack, being in that position probably was the safest place for Dauntless."
He didn't say that, though. He didn't because he knew he'd have to keep Dauntless safe all the way home to Alliance space. Fleet traditions be damned. Dauntless still carried the Syndic hypernet key, though few knew that besides Geary and Captain Dejani. Even if every other ship in the fleet was lost, getting that key back to Alliance space would give the Alliance a crucial advantage over the Syndics. Not that Geary intended sacrificing every other ship if there was any other possible way to get Dauntless back. Numos looked as if he were ready to say something else, so Geary stabbed a finger at the display of Sutra system hovering above the conference table.
"I hadn't intended bothering to divert from our transit of this system to deal with the inhabited worlds, but as you all know, we've learned something that changes those plans. We have indications that there's a labor camp on the fifth world that confines Alliance prisoners."
"Indications?" Captain Tulev asked shrewdly. "You don't think this is certain?"
Geary took a deep breath.
"We've already been tricked once in this system. It would have been easy for the Syndics to fake the message traffic that makes it seem there's Alliance personnel in that camp."
He easily sensed the rebellion rising around him.
"I fully intend going there and finding out for sure, but we have to be alert for another ambush."
"Bait to lure us near the fifth planet?" Colonel Karabali asked, her eyes narrowing in thought.
"It's possible. We'll be able to spot any minefields during our long approach to that world, no matter how stealthy they are. What else could there be that we'd have to worry about?"
The colonel shrugged. "You can mount truly massive weaponry on a planet like that, but it has to climb out of the gravity well and deal with the atmospheric effects to get its space targets. Besides, if they try to engage us with that kind of stuff, all we have to do is stand off and throw big rocks at the planet."
A studious-looking ship captain spoke up.
"You mean massive kinetic energy projectiles?"
"Yeah," the Marine colonel agreed. "That's what I said. BFRs. It's not that I'm thrilled about sending my boys and girls down to the surface of a Syndic-occupied world. We don't have nearly enough ground troops to secure the kind of perimeter we need for safety. But the entire planet will be hostage to the Syndic's good behavior, and we don't really have an alternative."
"We have to send the Marines down?" Geary asked.
Captain Dejani nodded. "After a few incidents, much earlier in the war, we determined that the Syndics would hold back some of their prisoners, especially any they thought of high value. The only way to confirm we've picked up everyone is to have our own personnel access the Syndic camp records for everything from body counts to food rations, to make sure our count matches the numbers they seem to have."
"All right."
That made sense, even if Geary didn't like the idea of sweeping the fleet close to the fifth planet and slowing down so his shuttles could pick up the prisoners.
I assume the Syndic shuttles aren't to be trusted, and we have to depend on our own.
Everyone nodded this time.
Everyone with shuttles on your ships, prepare them for some heavy use. I'll ask Co-President Rione to deliver our ultimatum to the Syndics regarding the prisoners.
Numos gave Geary a look of exaggerated disbelief. Why should she be involved? Not sure why Numos had developed a dislike of Rione, Geary answered bluntly.
She's our most capable negotiator.
Her blunders at Corvus nearly cost us the Titan.
Geary felt anger rising in him. The Syndic betrayal at Corvus involving merchant ships supposedly delivering supplies to the Alliance fleet hadn't been Rione's fault. Hadn't been anyone's fault, really. Surely Numos knew that.
That's not my assessment.
Of course not. Since Co-President Rione has been spending a great deal of time alone with you in your stateroom, I'm sure you think...
Geary cut off Numos with a fist slamming to the table's surface. Out of the corner of his eye, he could see the outraged faces of the commanders of ships belonging to the Rift Federation and the Callus Republic.
Captain Numos, you are out of order, Geary stated in a deathly low voice.
Captain Fariza stepped in with characteristic certitude.
Captain Numos is only stating what everyone...
Captain Fariza.
Geary stopped her with a glare.
I never thought to see the day when officers of the Alliance fleet would behave like gossips in a schoolyard. Both you and Captain Numos obviously need to review the personal and professional standards to which an officer is expected to adhere.
Fariza's face had gone white, Numos's red, but their eyes glinted with the same hatred of Geary.
Co-President Rione of the Callus Republic is a member of the Alliance Senate. She is to be treated with the respect that position requires. If you feel yourselves unable to provide due respect to a senior civilian member of the Alliance government, then you are obliged to submit your resignations from the fleet. I will not tolerate insults aimed at any officer or representative of the Alliance government in this fleet. Is that clear?
Geary took a long breath and looked around the table, unable to be sure how this latest speech had been received. Captain Tulev, his face grim, was nodding in agreement, though.
There's been too much gossip, too many rumors. Insults aimed at those in command, Tulev added with a glance at Numos.
Rumors that encouraged ship commanders to adhere to the old traditions of all-out pursuit, with consequences we have seen this day. A chill ran around the table at the direct reference to whatever might have motivated the captains of four ships to ignore Geary's orders and leave the formation to chase the Syndic warships. Captain Numos swallowed, his mouth working, then finally got out some words.
I had nothing to do with that, and if you're implying...
He's implying nothing, Geary snapped.
He's bringing to our attention that encouraging ships to ignore orders, that attempts to undermine the commander of this fleet, can have serious consequences.
I'm aware of the rumors Captain Tulev speaks of, and let me assure you that if I ever discover that anyone encouraged the commanding officers of the Annales, Basilard, Mace, and Cuirass...
He recited the name slowly to make sure their impact was felt.
To act in the way they did, I will personally make sure that whoever that is will wish they died an honorable death with the crews of those ships.
As he finished speaking, Geary let his gaze rest on Numos, who reddened so much more that he looked like he'd suffered a radiation burn. But Numos sat silently, having apparently realized that Geary was in no mood to be antagonized further.
Now, Geary continued in a calmer voice, at our present speed, we're about 40 hours from the fifth planet. Make sure the shuttles are ready. I have a plan here for distributing the Alliance personnel we pick up from the planet among the ships of the fleet.
It had been absurdly easy, just a matter of calling up the intelligent agent on his system and asking it how to add 5,000 more personnel to the ships in the fleet. Since that was a simple but tedious exercise in math, comparing berths and complements of personnel and support facilities on all of the available ships with the numbers needed, the computer had handled it within moments. It was the sort of thing fleet commanders had required staffs for in the old days, but the ability of automated systems to handle administrative and command tasks had eliminated much of the grunt work those staffs had handled. On top of that, Geary had learned that after the terrible losses suffered year in and year out in this apparently endless war,
The need for as many officers as possible to be available to crew replacement ships had led to the cannibalization of the remnants of the old staffs. Technically, as fleet commander, Geary was still authorized a chief of staff, but that officer had died, along with the former fleet commander, Admiral Block, as a result of Syndic treachery during negotiations. He was also authorized an aide, but Geary was damned if he was going to pull a junior officer out of combat to act as his personal servant.
"Look at the plan," Geary continued. "See what it says your ship can handle, and let me know if there's any problems with it. I want to know, so don't just suck it up and hope you can handle more than your ship is able to carry safely. There appear to be between 3,000 and 5,000 prisoners by initial estimates, which we can handle. We'll worry about identifying skills and any fleet personnel who were prisoners and getting them to ships that need them later. Colonel Carabali," the Marine nodded. "Prepare your Marines. I'd like to see your plan for handling this no later than 5 hours before we reach the planet." "Are there any questions?" Geary asked the entire group.
"How will we handle the Syndic military base on the fifth planet?" someone asked.
"That's yet to be determined," Geary advised.
He could see dissatisfaction rippling around the table. To many of his commanders, the only good Syndic was a dead Syndic, and no opportunity to kill Syndics should be passed up.
"I'll remind you that the installations in this system are obsolete. It costs the Syndics to keep them running. Leaving those installations intact means Syndic funds spent on them, and means Syndic troops trained and committed to them. If that base turns out to be a real threat, we'll take it out. Otherwise, I'm not interested in doing the Syndics a favor by removing it from the list of things they need to worry about."
He paused, trying to remember what else he'd planned on saying.
"We won't know if this is real until the Marines see Alliance prisoners of war at that camp. Everyone needs to stay alert."
He couldn't imagine even the Syndics would risk the population of a habitable world in order to try to destroy a few more Alliance ships. But then he'd seen a lot of things since he'd been rescued that he had never imagined.
"We have a chance to do a great good for people who never expected to be liberated. Thank the living stars for that. And let's do our ancestors proud."
The crowd dwindled with the usual amazing speed as the virtual images of ship captains vanished like popping soap bubbles, both Numos and Fariza disappearing on the very heels of Geary's dismissal. Captain Dejani, with a meaningful glare at the place where those two had apparently been sitting, shook her head, and then excused herself before leaving the compartment the old-fashioned way by walking out. As Geary had hoped, the reassuring image of Captain Duelos remained at the end. Duelos also indicated the places where Numos and Fariza had been.
"I wouldn't have said this before, but those two are a danger to this fleet."
Geary sat back, feeling weary and rubbing his forehead.
"You wouldn't have said that before what?"
"Before 4 ships of this fleet set off on an insane charge."
The image of Duello seemed to walk up to Geary and take the next seat.
"Valiant, glorious, brainless. I have no proof, but I know Numos was behind that."
"I figure he is too."
"But," Geary admitted bitterly, "the lack of proof is the problem. My command of this fleet is still far too shaky. If I start sacking commanding officers, especially one with Numos' seniority, without being able to prove misconduct, I might find way too many of my other ships valiantly and brainlessly dashing into minefields." Captain Duelos looked down and grimaced.
"The lesson of those 4 ships was a powerful one. No matter what lies Numos encourages, everyone will remember that you were right to warn those ships off and to avoid chasing pell-mell after a few Syndic hucks."
Geary couldn't help a snort of derision.
"You'd think being right would gain me a little more credit than that. What do you think? Will everyone follow my orders when we approach the fifth planet?"
"At this point, yes."
"Do you have any idea where that nonsense about Co-President Rione came from?"
Duelos looked mildly surprised.
"I assumed you two were on friendly terms, but even if you're extremely friendly, it's no affair of mine. Co-President Rione is not an officer or sailor under your command, and a personal relationship with her has no bearing on your performance in command."
Geary stared for a moment, then laughed.
"Personal relationship? With Co-President Rione?"
This time, Duello shrugged.
Scuttlebutt declares that you spend time together alone.
For conferences. I need her advice.
Geary laughed again.
By our ancestors, Victoria Rione doesn't like me at all. She makes no bones about it. I frighten her because she worries I'll turn into Blackjack Geary at any moment and sail this fleet home to depose the elected leaders of the Alliance and become God Emperor or something.
Co-President Rione is a shrewd and intelligent woman, Duellos observed with absolute seriousness.
She's told you she doesn't like you?
Yes, she... Come to think of it, Rione had several times expressed distrust of Geary, but he couldn't remember at the moment her ever saying she didn't like him.
Yeah, I think so.
Duello shrugged again.
Whether she does or not makes no difference. I say once more, she is not your subordinate, not in the military at all, and any personal relationship with her is perfectly appropriate. Should one occur.
Geary couldn't help a third laugh as he bade farewell to Captain Duello's. But as he began to leave the room, he paused in thought. Surely Rione's spies in the fleet had reported to her the rumors about a relationship between her and Geary. Why hadn't Rione told him of those rumors when she'd spoken of the other rumors? Could the iron politician he dealt with actually be embarrassed by the rumors? But if so, why had she continued visiting him? Geary leaned one arm against the bulkhead for a moment, staring at the deck, remembering the first days after he was revived from the survival sleep that had kept him alive for a century. A span of time in which everyone in his life had died in battle or of old age. The shock of learning that everyone he had once known and loved, men and women, were long dead, had led him to wall off the idea of new relationships. The ice that had once filled him seemed almost gone. But it still occupied that one place, afraid to retreat and let warmth grow again. He'd lost everyone once. It could happen again. He didn't want it to hurt so much the next time.
Chapter 2. The fifth planet looked exactly like the sort of place made for a Syndic labor camp. Too far from its sun to ever know a true summer, most of the world seemed to be featureless fields of tundra that on rare occasions ran into bare, jagged mountain ranges rising like islands from the sea of low, tough vegetation. Glaciers extending from the poles appeared to hold a good portion of the planet's water, with only shallow, small seas dotting the areas not covered by ice. Looking at the dismal place, Geary didn't have any trouble understanding why Sutra hadn't been deemed worthy of the expense of a hypernet gate. Unless the fourth planet was an absolute paradise, which it certainly wasn't since it was a shade too close to its sun and probably unpleasantly warm. Sutra was just the sort of place that had ceased to matter when the Syndic hypernet was created. Once, using the system jump drives that could take ships from star to star, anyone going anywhere had to transverse all of the star systems in between. Every one of those systems was guaranteed a certain amount of traffic passing through en route to other destinations. But the hypernet allowed ships to go directly from one star to another, no matter how far the distance between them. Without the ships passing through, and without any particular value other than as the homes of people who had suddenly found themselves living in nowhere, the systems off the hypernet were slowly dying, with everyone who could migrate moving to hypernet-linked systems. The human communities on the fifth planet of Sutra were fading even faster than usual. Judging from what the Alliance sensors could see, fully two-thirds of the former habitations on the world were now vacant, showing no signs of heating or activity. Geary focused back on the depiction of the labor camp on the fifth planet. There were mines nearby, which might represent actual economic value, but also might exist solely as a place to work the life from the prisoners in the camp. There weren't any walls, but then there didn't have to be. Outside the camp was nothing but those empty fields of tundra. Escape would simply be a suicide, unless someone tried to get out through the landing field. And there, walls of razor wire did exist. He became aware that Captain Dejani was waiting patiently for his attention.
Sorry, Captain. What do you think of my plan?
Geary, uncomfortable with trying to place his fleet in orbit around the planet,
had put together a plan calling for the fleet to slow down, dropping the shuttles as it passed closest to the world, then looping around in a wide turn outside the orbits of the fifth planet's small moons, before returning again to pick up the shuttles as they returned with the liberated prisoners.
"The pickup would go quicker if we put ships in orbit," Desjani suggested.
"Yeah." Geary frowned at the display. "There's no sign of minefields. We can't see any major defensive weaponry on the planet, and even the Syndic military base there seems to be half shut down. Something's still bothering me."
Desjani nodded thoughtfully. "After the Syndic attempt to use merchant ships on suicide missions against us, it's understandable to be worried about undetected threats."
"The Syndics had time to lay that minefield trap for us. That means they also had time to try to conceal that labor camp, or even try to move the prisoners in it. But there's no sign they did that."
"Why?"
"Because it's bait far more attractive to us than those light warships near the jump point. The sort of thing we can't pass up."
"Yet there's no sign of an ambush this time. No sign of anything that could strike at us."
"No," Geary agreed,
wondering if he really was just being hyper-cautious.
Co-President Rion said the Syndic civilian planetary leader she talked to seemed scared witless, but not a single military officer was available to talk. That made Desjani frown.
"Interesting. But what could they be planning? If there was anything hidden, we should have spotted it."
Geary tapped some controls irritably. "Let's assume we do go into orbit. The fleet's so big, we'd have to be way out from the planet."
"These moons will be an annoyance, but they're not much bigger than asteroids. Any formations running past them can dodge easily enough, since they're traveling in a loose cluster and on fixed orbits."
"Yeah. And we have to swing past the moons anyway, even with my plan."
He scowled at the display. Nothing he'd learned of the war since being rescued seemed to be helping, so Geary cast his mind back, trying to remember the lessons imparted to him by experienced officers long dead, the sort of professionals who'd been killed in the earliest decades of the war, along with everyone they'd managed to teach their tricks of the trade. For some reason, the sight of the small moons triggered memories of one such trick. A single ship hiding behind a much larger world to lunge out on a passing target. That didn't make sense. The moons of the fifth planet were too small for anything but a few light units to hide behind, and even suicide attacks by such small ships would fail against the massed might of the Alliance fleet, concentrated in a tight formation to minimize the distance the shuttles would have to travel. But what had the commander of that other ship said?
"If I'd been a snake, I could have bit you. I was right on top of you, and you didn't even know it."
Geary grinned unpleasantly.
"I think I know what the Syndic military is planning, and why those civilians on the fifth world are so scared. Let's make a few modifications to this plan of mine."
The fifth world, which Geary had now learned had been given the poetic name Sutra 5 in typical Syndicate Worlds bureaucratic style, lay only 30 minutes away now at the Alliance fleet's current velocity. Under his original plan, the fleet would have begun braking and swinging to port now, setting up a pass over the planet and inevitably crossing through the space where the moons of Sutra were orbiting. He glanced at the five moons again. They orbited in a cluster, only a few tens of thousands of kilometers from each other. Once upon a time, they'd probably been a single large chunk of matter, but at some point, tidal stresses from the fifth planet, or perhaps the near passage of some other large object, had torn that single moon into the five fragments. Geary tapped his communications controls.
"Captain Tulev, are your ships ready?"
"Standing by," Tulev reported, his voice betraying no excitement.
"You may fire when ready," Geary ordered.
"Understood. Firing projectiles now."
On Geary's display, large objects detached themselves from the bulks of Tulev's ships, hurled forward by propulsion and guidance packs that boosted their speed a little higher than the nearly 0.1 light speed of the fleet. Co-President Rion, occupying the observer's seat on the bridge of the Dauntless, stared at Geary.
"We're firing? At what?"
"Those moons," Geary advised.
He noticed Captain Desjani trying to hide a smile at Rion's surprise.
"The moons of the Fifth World?"
Co-President Rion's voice expressed skeptical curiosity.
Do you have some particular dislike of moons, Captain Geary?
Not usually.
Geary got a perverse satisfaction out of knowing that Rione's spies in his fleet hadn't heard about this operation. She waited, then finally unbent enough to ask more.
Why are you launching an attack on those moons?
Because I think they're weapons.
Geary tapped some controls, bringing up magnified images of the moons, their surfaces resembling those of asteroids.
See this?
Signs that excavation activity was conducted.
Well concealed, so we had to look for it to find it, but there it is.
On a small airless moon? Rione asked. How can you tell it's recent?
We can't from here, but all five moons show the same signs.
I see.
Whatever else could be said about Rione, she thought quickly.
What do you think was buried inside these moons, Captain Geary?
Firecrackers, Madam Co-President. Really big firecrackers.
The images representing the massive kinetic energy projectiles, or big rocks in marine terminology, were steadily pulling away from Tulev's ships on a curving trajectory aimed at the moons. Despite the incredible amount of damage they could inflict, such weapons couldn't usually be used because they were too easily dodged by anything able to maneuver. But the moons were on fixed orbits, following the same track around the fifth world that they'd coursed for innumerable years. It was strange to think that after today those moons would orbit that world no more. Geary activated the fleet command circuit.
All units, execute pre-planned maneuver Sigma at time 4-5.
The time scrolled down, and every ship in the fleet turned itself, using their propulsion systems to reduce their velocity and simultaneously altering course to starboard, to pass Sutra 5 on the side away from where the moons of that world had their dates with the projectiles launched by the Alliance fleet. Geary watched and waited, taking pleasure in the intricate ballet, all of those ships moving in unison against the darkness of space. Even the lumbering and partially misnamed fast fleet auxiliaries like Titan and Witch moved with what seemed unusual nimbleness. 20 minutes later, as the decelerating Alliance fleet was still approaching Sutra 5, the huge solid metal projectiles launched by Tulev's ships slammed at a speed of just over 30,000 kilometers per second almost simultaneously into the five moons of Sutra. Even the smallest moon was massive.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.